This video is brought to you by HelloFresh.
The whole purpose of critical race theory is to provide Americans with a way to understand the legacy of racism, even though those stories sometimes hurt.
Have you heard about critical race theory?
Critical race theory.
Critical race theory.
The teaching of critical race theory.
How would you define critical race theory?
This is American history. All of it should be taught.
Teaching the facts will bring the country together, not divide the country.
Not about not teaching history. We're about teaching history in an objective way that is not represented as America is systemically racist.
Do we need more critical race theory if that's what it means, teaching the truth? We need more of that in schools.
Testing curriculum for students as young as 4 years old, where they are teaching them this ideology.
Critical race theory is anti-meritocratic. It believes that merit is racist.
The proposed amendment that y'all are looking at requires that teachers define American history based on standards in the Declaration of Independence. At that time in our history, black people were property and they weren't even considered to be people.
You know, when we are trying to figure out how to deal with any kind of social problems, we do not overstep and overreact.
You're teaching children to hate others because of their skin color.
We say,
your time is up, thank you.
Allow teachers to teach the truth.
The debate that we're having right now is over the study of race, racism, and inequality in history and in public policy, and certainly how those things have been taught throughout history, how they've been understood throughout history, and then how they are part of the larger American story that we tell each other and one another, and including our students.
Gossip Girl here, your one and only stop into the scandalous lives of Manhattan's elite.
Ooh, yo, if there's a job out there for somebody to just do a voiceover of a teen drama, sign me up. I won't copy Kristen Bell. I'll do something else, but you need your focus.
Bodycon dress. A bodycon dress. A bodycon dress. Boom, boom. A bodycon dress, bodycon dress, and it's ripped all over, turn a drunk man sober, my bodycon dress.
See, I always do that, and because I haven't been practicing singing for like ever, I'm my stamina is not what it used to be, you know? Hello and welcome back to my channel. My name is Khadija, your favorite internet play auntie. Hello to all my returning nieces, nephews, and niblings, and my fellow aunties, uncles, piblings. If you're new, feel free to take a look around. Suss out the vibe. I just sit in my little workspace and talk about
whatever I want and sing about my outfits.
And try to do light ASMR for my audience because I know a lot of you really enjoy this. Destroy the
kidding. Oh my god. I'm kidding. Okay, no. I shouldn't say that. YouTube
demonetized
my whole ass channel and I'm living with my parents again. Such a millennial cliche, damn. Even those of us born in the 90s got it. What am I doing? Okay, so today we are going to be talking about one of the most contentious issues fanning the flames of the US culture wars. I mean, there are like a lot these days, but this is like the CRT. We're talking about critical race theory. Yes, that critical race theory. To be transparent, when my dad first suggested I do a video about this, I was like,
no, I don't wanna. Too many people are fighting over it.
And his response was, research, research, research. So, you know, what can I say? I aim to please my father. So I did my research and this video will hopefully become a resource to those of you that are familiar with critical race theory, but are having maybe a hard time explaining it or its foundations, its origins, principles, all that sort of stuff. For any of you that don't know what it is and you're curious to just learn more because you're having a hard time navigating the media hellstorm about all of this. It's not really a hellstorm, I'm being dramatic, but it's a lot of debate. And hopefully it can also be a resource for those of you pretending to know what it is.
On both sides of the political spectrum, I told you this would be an ASMR video.
So, because I know that this is a very heated topic, because there's a lot of misinformation out there about what critical race theory is and what it is not, I am going to do my best to add as much nuance into the conversation whilst also presenting the facts as I have researched them and had them fact-checked. This by no means is a complete guide to critical race theory. I'm not an expert on this theory. I'll have resources to all of my links in the description below, as well as any extra readings that I did and the links that Maddie used to fact check everything. Also, I'll talk about some critical race theorists generally, so you can always look them up and hear directly from their mouths what this theory is and is not. Because I think even people that are for this theory, and hopefully I don't do it in this video, but I might, are maybe misspeaking when they speak about critical race theory, because I don't know, anyone can be an expert these days. This is also going to be kind of like a trilogy in a way, because in exploring this topic, it also allowed me to explore other ideas about moral panics, what culture wars are, the ideal of bread and circuses, and I actually found a really cool expert to talk about another theory that I think could be a really interesting dynamic and addition to this conversation, and who knows, could possibly work in tandem with critical race theory. I don't know, we'll see. But they're an expert in this, so I'm excited. All of that will happen in the coming weeks. Boy, all of this explaining has left me famished. Wish I had a environmentally conscious weekly meal plan service that I could depend upon to quell this hunger. Oh, wait! HelloFresh is America's number one meal service, helping the girls get out of their weekly recipe rut. In Canada, we could be on game two if more of y'all, you know, use my discount code. Like, dang, I'm kidding. But, like, serious. You know what I'm saying? So HelloFresh has a variety of meal plans from low-cal to carb-smart to vegetarian to pescatarian, and every recipe is packed with fresh produce sourced directly from farmers. So I've been using HelloFresh since I last worked with them on my Tyra video, and I may or may not have been using my own discount code.
We love a discount code, okay?
Honestly, y'all, I really do like HelloFresh a lot, and I can't stop saying amazing things about them. So if you want to try them out, see if they can make your life a little easier for a little while, then go to HelloFresh.com and enter promo code Khadija14, that's K-H-A-D-I-J-A, 14 the number, to get 14 free meals, including shipping. They gave me two more than last time, y'all! That's because they want you to have some more free meals! Again, that's HelloFresh.com, promo code Khadija14, so they know Auntie sent you. Thank you to HelloFresh for sponsoring today's video, and let's get into the mess.
Do you guys know what critical race theory is?
No, we're not quite sure.
No?
No, same.
I don't.
No, not exactly.
I do not.
No, I don't.
I don't.
I think I have a decent idea about it, but honestly, I can't say I'm an expert on the subject.
I had to get wine, because you know. You know. So critical race theory comes from a subfield of critical legal studies, and because it's a theory, it's hard to pin down one uniform definition. But I read a few different sources for this, so some similar themes kept popping up. So at a glance, CRT or critical race theory, I'll be interchanging those phrasings or ways of saying it, can be defined as a theory that examines the social construction of how race is used to oppress and exploit non-white people, particularly through the law and legal institutions in the United States, which are deemed as inherently racist because they're built on white supremacy. How'd I do, Derek Bell? Kimberly Crenshaw? Richard Delgado, what's up, y'all? So the actual theory of CRT is said to have originated out of the 1970s. When you're reading about this, it's just the 70s and 80s that this theory began to kind of gain momentum, because critical race theory started as a response by legal scholars who were noticing a real slowing down of progress
after the civil rights movement, a real slowing down of Black progress after the civil rights movement. According to critical race theory, past, present, future, there are two moments cited as contributing to the development of CRT. The first one being when Harvard Law School invited Jack Greenberg, a longtime litigator with the NAACP Defense Fund and the chief architect of Brown v. Board of Education. They invited him and Julius Chambers to co-teach a course called Race, Racism, and American Law. And what is the issue, you ask? Well, Julius was Black and Jack was white. Normalize looking over both shoulders before you say the word white.
See, somebody's gonna take that joke the wrong way. Gosh darn it.
So Harvard Law School students of color weren't happy with this. As a result, they boycotted the class, which was enrolled by mostly white students. I'm assuming mostly white liberals, you know, but who knows? And in true, oh, so y'all wanna play fashion, they created their own, essentially their own course. And it was informal. They met outside of course hours or outside of normal class hours and it enabled them to invite their own guest lecturers.
Khadija, you might know a little something, something about being frustrated about a school's progress and creating your own course.
Go to marigoldmusicprogram.com to support us. Anyway, after Derrick Bell, who I briefly mentioned before, he's a notable figure in critical race theory, said to be the father of CRT. After he left Harvard Law School, the school made it seem like they were unable to find a Black professor with the right experience to replace him. When Bell left Harvard to become Dean of University of Oregon Law School, student activists who demanded the hire of a professor of color were told by Harvard administration that, quote, there were no qualified Black scholars who merited Harvard's interest. This was in the 80s. Anyways, the second event was the 1987 Critical Legal Studies National Conference on Silence and Race. That must have been fun to print on flyers. Oh, what are you going to? CLSNCSR? Sounds like a car. Okay, sorry. This conference was said by Kimberly Crenshaw, the woman we have to thank for the term intersectionality and one of the OGs of CRT. About this conference, she said that it, quote, marked the genesis of an intellectually distinctive critical account of race on terms set forth by race-conscious scholars of color and the terms of contestation and coalition with CLS. So now that we know at a glance what critical race theory is and how it got started, let's peel back the layers a little bit to really understand why some people are about this theory and why others hate it with the fiery hot passion of a thousand white suns. So the general philosophies and themes that I noticed about CRT from this research goes as follows. Critical race theory is closely connected to history, philosophy, legal studies, and sociology. And it's a movement that at its origins can be characterized most by skepticism, meaning that the early subscribers of this theory believed slash believe that racism is permanent and will never end. Bell's term for this is racial realism, and in one of the papers that I read, they basically explained that this means that racial prejudice is so deeply ingrained in our society structures that Black people must resign themselves to it forever being a feature of the national landscape. When we get to the cons section, I'll talk a bit about that, but just put a pin in that for now. Another point of this theory is that Black folks haven't achieved economic stride because of idealism or inspired advocacy, and more so because the interest of the white elite has been tied to Black economic determinism at certain points in time. AKA, any achievement that Black folks have made have been because white elites have a vested interest in how it will help them look better. And again, put a pin in that because when we get to the cons, I'll talk a bit about that because I think if you just read it and you don't maybe know a context of with which this person means, it can seem very absolute. Either way, I know some of y'all are hearing that and you're thinking,
so the detractors are right. CRT is about making non-white people, specifically Black people, feel bad about being Black and know that they're always gonna be oppressed. What the f-?
At a glance, doesn't look good, but if we take a second to put our dissecting hats on, we can see that what Bell means is that race is a part of our society that is never going away, and that we can't get swept up in the strides that we've made because a lot of those advancements have more to do with white elite self-interest. That still sounded bad.
again. When we get to the cons, we'll talk, okay? Everything that I just explained about the whole economic strides of Black folks and all that sort of stuff being tied to white elitist interests, self-interest and all of that stuff is a term that was first foreshadowed by Charles Beard and was attributed to Derrick Bell. And that is called interest convergence. The strides that we as Black people have made, the interest converges. It aligns with white elitist self-interest. So they look good and Black people get progress in the end. And some people might say, well, what's the big deal? At least the progress happens. Other people are like, no, but it's the morals of it all. There's actually some proof that Bell might've been right about interest convergence, specifically when we look at Brown v. Board of Education. We've all heard about Brown v. Board of Education. It was the monumental Supreme Court decision that allowed for the desegregation of American schools. But what was the US of A's real motivation behind this? See, after World War II and the Korean War, Black people were exposed to less racist environments than America. Traveling overseas, fighting wars and stuff. Doesn't mean they were exempt from racism, but it wasn't as bad as it was in the States at that time. So from this theory and interest convergence, Black folks ended up being reluctant to come back to America to do all this grunt work, domestic work for a country that didn't care about their values, their interests, or valued them as people beyond the services they could provide. And of course, the blatant racism and discrimination. Can't forget about that. Real racial unrest was a possibility unless the US did something. As well, the US was at the beginning of the Cold War and, you know, they needed allies against the communists. Allies from developing countries that were mostly Black, Brown, and Asian. So when I'm talking about allies from developing nations, I mean that the US was like, we do not want this communist nonsense to be spreading. And there's this idea that if communism started to spread, or there was this idea that if communism was around countries close to the United States, it was only a matter of time before it ended up on US soil. So Bell hypothesized that Brown v. Board of Education came when it did to improve America's image as the democratic, freedom of speech, land of opportunity, and to show US allies that America was making strides to all this racial unrest, or doing their best to prevent the possibility of a lot of racial unrest. I know what you might be thinking.
I don't believe it. That sounds like some Antifa propaganda. Khadija, why are you trying to rewrite history?
Would you believe me if I said I had proof? Facts don't care about your feelings, right? About 10 years after Bell let his suspicions be known, Mary Dudziak spilled the tea in the Stanford Law Review about an investigation she did into the files of the US Department of State. I'm just gonna read from the paper again, CRT Past, Present, Future. Mary Dudziak, writing in the Stanford Law Review, reported the results of her investigation in the files of the US Department of State, including the discovery of a series of memoranda to the Department of Justice, urging that arm of government to assist the Black cause. The great breakthrough then appears to be just what Bell predicted, a case of interest convergence, one of those rare times when the fortunes of Blacks and of whites were aligned. And you can actually read this report online, the one that Mary Dudziak did. I'll leave it in the folder with all the extra readings I did for this video. Now again, all that still sounds bad, you know, it still sounds bad, but the theory has roots in skepticism, so what did you expect? Also, facts don't care about your feelings, right? And while I don't agree that all strides made by non-white people are only the results of white elitist self-interest, I do agree that sometimes that's the case. And generally speaking, race isn't real, but racism is, so here we are. Anyways, the reason that I'm trying to be careful with how I unpack the skepticism that's at the heart of this theory is because I want to make sure the detractors of this theory understand that CRT has started one way and has evolved over time. And there's a lot of nuance in critical race theory. And just because the actual theory itself, a dense and vast one with hearts and skepticism is presented in a certain way, doesn't mean it's going to be presented in that exact way in schools. But to quickly just throw in here, and I'll say it again later, there's no evidence that it's actually already being taught in schools. I don't know why people keep saying that. That factually, that's just not what's happening.
Critical race theory isn't the best term for what they're reacting to.
The founding principles of critical race theory are still there, but it's not as simple as saying white people are bad and oppressors and
Black people or any non-white people are victims and the oppressed. And it can be easy to immediately jump to that when you hear something like racial realism or his interest convergence theory. Something that my dad told me that I really appreciated was that nothing is in absolutes. Just because Bell came up with interest convergence or race realism doesn't mean that at every time, or that he at every time blames everything on white people and thinks that there's no room for Black or non-whites to progress on their own merit. And if he does, or if he thought that way, and I didn't know him, then fine. But I don't think most modern proponents of critical race theory think in this way, because there's no nuance in that sort of thinking. And that is an exhausting and presumptuous existence to have, mein Gott. So within critical race theory, or I can't technically say this is within critical race theory. This is just based off the paper that I read that started talking about other types of theories that have branched off from this. One of the branches is LatCrit, and I'm gonna be using the language in the papers, but it's where Latinos have been examining how other racialized minorities can get left out of conversations and policies around anti-discrimination, conversations that can literally be Black and white. There's also critical race feminism, and that is examining the relations between men and women of color, the impact that welfare changes on Black and brown families, the sterilization of Black women, and I'm hoping they are adding the sterilization of Indigenous women into that. And there's critical international human rights, because not everything is about the Western world. And that theory examines things like genital mutilation, the helpfulness of NAFTA when it comes to developing nations, US exploitation of emerging nations, you know, how they like to keep certain power structures and corruption in place to serve their own economic self-interest, you know, that pesky old US tradition. Things like slavery, honor killings, female infanticide, international prostitution. Again, I'm just using the language that was in the paper. So under the umbrella of critical race theory, there are all of these other avenues that to me read as just wanting people to think critically about the world around them and examine the harmful structures put in place as a result of social constructs that are mostly arbitrary. Now that we have all that information, let's talk about the pros and cons of critical race theory.
You know, I talk about we live in certain times. Some people think of like, oh, you mean uncertain times. No. There is a great deal of moral ideological certainty at this moment. And that's why people are scared. Because if you come from the point of view of certainty, you know, you're saying, oh my God, we're not teaching them the noble truths of the founding of the United States. But if you come from the other side saying that we're not teaching the fundamental truths about the evil of the United States, it's understandable why people don't trust each other on these topics.
I could sit up here and lie to you about how objective I'm being with this pros and cons list, but I don't believe in insulting your intelligence. The more I've learned about critical race theory, the more I've realized that the cons I initially had coming into this video were mostly negligible. The objections I had or hesitations were quelled once I just learned about what the theory was from multiple sources, because I was able to find different interpretations and different perspectives that helped kind of calm me down a bit about it. I still have apprehensions about little things here and there, but everything will have that. And all you need to do is just, you know, keep on reading, I guess, because reading is what? Yeah, it is. So Priscilla found an article that points to the benefits of critical race theory in inspiring and motivating organizers and activists by Jerusha Osberg Connor. I hope I'm saying your name right, Jerusha. She's a professor of education at Villanova University and has written over 40 peer-reviewed journal articles, often doing studies on student voices, student engagement, and youth organizing and activism. So I think she's pretty qualified. So let's go through the list from her studies. And this article is also going to be linked in everything. It's from The Conversation, and it is a quote from Maddie. Really good source for finding explanatory journalism articles by academics. She was telling me that it basically just takes all the stuff that's usually really dense from journal articles and packages them in a more accessible way, like in the form of a list or just a simple article. So The Conversation, it'll be linked in the works cited. So Connor firstly says that learning critical race theory actually helps students and youth organizers feel passionate and motivated to take action. Young people who learn about this end up developing this sort of hope that reform is actually possible because they have a tangible and practical way to make changes, because they know, oh, systemic oppression is a thing. It's not on me that like I haven't been able to make the advancements of other peers. So now I know what I could do to combat that, you know? And I do have agency and power, you know what I mean? This passion also helps young people move from the quote, binary lens of victim or oppressor and into agents of change. Because again, they have the knowledge and language to critically examine social structures, and they know that something can be done about it. They have the context of history behind them with critical race theory. They have philosophy embedded in that, and they can look at the law and be like, how are these all connected? And what can I do to change it? Another benefit is that youth being active in critical race theory inspired organizing and movements actually improves their performance at school, or improves their academic, as Osberg Connor puts it. Second, research shows youth organizers become more academically successful in school as they progress through organizing. Ironically, research shows that while youth organizing helps young people become more aware of inequalities within and across schools, it can also make them less alienated in school and more committed to academics. So in her third point, Osberg Connor found that learning about critical race theory and getting involved in activism actually has lifelong benefits for the youth she studied. Alumni explain how the values and dispositions cultivated in organizing led them not only to adopt pro-social careers as, for example, educators or counselors, but also to find ways to continue to participate constructively in the civic life of their communities as young adults. I know I was reading a lot of her quotes, but she's an expert in this. As much as I don't like the elitism of academia, I think it is important to center experts at things so that we have as much information as possible from the people that have dedicated their lives to studying these things. You know what I mean? In these examples, critical race theory is not just about teaching critical thinking. It's about inspiring young people to become the type of people who are actively involved in shaping their futures, not passively experiencing them. Put that on a slogan next time you want to get young people to vote, since y'all don't know how to do it, apparently. Last quote from this. Studies of youth organizing show that when taught well, the analytical tools of critical race theory can support valuable long-term educational, professional, civic, and political outcomes. Now we get to the cons. So here are some quotes that I had pulled from different news stories, like news stories that I watched off of YouTube. And a lot of them are going to be paraphrased because this was the general consensus of what people are saying. They're not going to be, some of them are direct quotes that people have actually said in a lot of these interviews, and some of them are just paraphrasing. So just know that going into this. So one of the first things that people view as a con of critical race theory is that it's about rewriting history is what people think of it, right? So with critical race theory, from my understanding of this, and I'll keep saying that and reiterating that because I'm not trying to claim any expertise on this, but from my understanding of it, based off of my own research, it's not about rewriting history, it's about trying to tell history from a different perspective. Too long, American history, and I went to school in America for the first 15 years of my life, so I can speak to the education system there and the one in Canada, because I went to Canadian schools the last while as well. For too long, it centers this perspective of we fought for our freedom, the Civil War happened, the slaves were free, the civil rights happened, racism was abolished, the end. History is not being revised here. It's being taught in a more authentic and uncomfortable way because it's being shown from all angles, not just from the angle that looks, that makes America look the best. And Canada, y'all do this too. Do not act like you don't. I don't even think I learned any Black history in Canada. And once in a while, they'll teach you a bit about residential schooling, and that's pretty much it. Why was I learning so much about the Russian czars? It seems that some parents believe that learning history in this authentic way, this more well-rounded way, is too violent for a lot of their kids to hear. But selling a sanitized history to your children about how great the land they were born on is indoctrination, no matter how your children are racialized, it's indoctrination. Speaking of indoctrination, some people will say that they don't want critical race theory being taught in schools because they don't want their taxpayer money going to indoctrinating their kids. Hey Siri, what's the definition of indoctrination?
I couldn't get her to say it, so I'll just read it. Ugh.
The process of teaching a person or group to accept a set of beliefs uncritically.
Baby, your taxpayer money is already going to indoctrinating your children.
Another argument against critical race theory, or con that people see of critical race theory, is that it's teaching every white person that they are racist and that racism is fundamental in American society. It's teaching white people to hate their country, the color of their skin. And again, based off my understanding of CRT, it does claim, yes, that racism is baked into the DNA of America, that the structure itself is racist. That is how it's a fundamental part of society. Therefore, white folks are racist because they are products and originated from the founders and creators, thanks Maddie for adding that, of that society. It's not saying you are racist, you are racist, you are. It's saying the society, the system is. And because of that, all of us, whether we want to admit it or not, are or are capable of being, unfortunately, especially because we can observe difference. You follow? I feel like CRT is just such a, another con of it is because it's called critical race theory, and this is just me talking semantics and stuff. People feel like they're being hit over the head with it. You know what I mean? Whereas, and I keep talking about this, but the stroke, slap method of lulling people in and then slapping them with the information, if it was called something like implicit bias theory, people would be a little more accepting of it. It's still the same thing, but you know how people are. We all have different relationships with certain words, language has a history and a memory, blah, 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 blah. So here's where my own personal sort of critiques come in with this. While I do believe that institutionalized oppression is a part of American and Canadian societies, while I do agree that changes need to happen institutionally to combat racism and systemic inequality all around, there perhaps needs to be a different strategy in terms of teaching this principle, I think. And not even just teaching it because, again, as I said, there isn't evidence that it's already being taught in schools. People are freaking out about it, but they're freaking out about something that hasn't actually even happened yet. But having said all that, I think as a society, we do just need to become more comfortable with the word racist and understand that it doesn't have the exact same, the images of people seeing KKK members wandering around yelling slurs at people of color. Just put that image on the shelf, because yes, that is racism, yes. But just put that on the shelf, because that's not what everyone is talking about when they're saying racist now. That's not the immediate, that's so obvious. It's just kind of like, we all just know that that is, you know what I mean? As a society, we have to expand our gaze on how we talk about racism. And the first way is to remove the stigma around that word, the negative stigma around that word. Because yes, it is negative. It is not a good thing to be racist, but it does not make you as a human fundamentally bad because you are a product of your environment. Do you know what I mean? It goes back to what I always say in videos that I got from the channel Costuming Drama, which is, you're not responsible for the first thought that pops into your head, but you are responsible for the second one and how you respond after that. It is not your fault that you think something that is low-key racist on like an individual level, or you work at a place that is mostly whatever type of race, or you know, like, it's not someone's fault for that, but it's how they observe, critique, and analyze that and respond in practical ways after. That's when you have to look and see, okay, am I upholding systems of racism? Am I doing this on an individual? Well, ooh, I almost spilled my wine. Am I doing this on an individual level in my everyday life? You can't control the body you were born into. I'm not gonna walk up to every single white person and be like,
it's your fault I didn't get that raise.
Girl, what? No. And most people that are sensibly talking about critical race theory are not, that's not the motive here. I would hope. If that's the motive, then bye, but that's not the motive here from what I'm observing. At the end of the day, if we are all capable of implicit bias, then we are all capable of racism. And everyone is so much more comfortable with hearing implicit bias than racism, which is why I say we need to remove the stigma around it. Did I slur my words? Which is why I say we need to remove the stigma around it, because say it with me, y'all. If we are all capable of implicit bias, then we are all capable of racism. Imagine that. Imagine. Don't you feel a little better? I'm saying it for myself too. Don't worry. It's okay. Don't be ashamed. CRT, as I've said before, is a theory rooted in skepticism, which I think is an important characteristic to have with critical thinking. You may not feel like a KKK burning crosses, yelling slurs racist, but that's the thing about language. It evolves over time. It has a history and a memory, and it's important for us to remember that, but it's also something that we have to move past as a society so that we can start having honest, awkward, interesting, weird, uncomfortable, and surprisingly all right conversations about racism. Something I like to do with racialized white people in my life, and I'm saying racialized white because I'm gonna try and be better about saying racialized people, because all of us are racialized, but something that I try to do is make sure that we can have honest combos about racism, because to me, if I can't do that with you, then what's the point of us even being friends? We can't ignore this real thing that lives around us in society, but that none of us can ever quite grasp at, but we can all kind of like sense, you know? I'm not in any way, shape, or form about making my friends feel bad about their whiteness, just like I hope you wouldn't look at any non-white people, any racialized people of color as charity cases, as oppressed charity cases. We all have to remove our rose-colored glasses about what the world is and what it is not. Rose-colored glasses, we're socialized to think that we're all just good and kumbaya and everyone's great. Taking them off, we're like, uh-oh, this ain't so cute. We all have a choice when it comes to this conversation about racism, and we can learn to lean into that choice, lean into that discomfort, that fear, and let it inform us going forward, because emotions are information, and this is an emotional topic. Even if people don't want to talk about their feelings aspect of it, it gets me riled up. And the fear specifically tells me that a lot of folks don't want to believe that they are capable of doing harm to others by being racist to others or complicit in a system that is racially oppressive, amongst other kinds of oppression. But to be honest, that shouldn't be something any of us shy away from, because that should be a kernel of hope, actually. Because deep down, you're saying, I don't want to harm you or be shitty to you, and I feel terrible that the world is this way, but guess what? We can do something about it. Just as race was taught to us because of racist ideas, we can teach something different. Something that doesn't ignore the realities of racism, but moves beyond those borders. Because I guess we'll get into the other two mini gripes that I have with CRT, is this feeling that things are in absolutes. And I know I said, hopefully Derek Bell didn't think in this way of like, absolutely, interest convergence. Every advancement Black people make is just about white elitist self-interest, and racism is never gonna go away, and blah, blah, blah. Like, obviously, I'm hoping that that's not the case. But if it is, that's where I kind of have a disconnect, because, and I don't have that disconnect every day, I should say. It's where I have that disconnect some days, because some days I'm like, you're right, racism never going away. Like, this is all just so people can make money. It's performative activism. It's virtue signaling, and I'm tired of it. You know, some days I just feel like that. But other days there's this spark of hope in me by how emotional and energized I see people on either side that shows me that like people deeply care. And that's what I'm trying to speak to more than anything else. I also want to say that I just want to be cautious of participating in a infantilization of racialized Black folks, because I don't know, there's something about the ideal of internalizing oppression and starting to believe false narratives that have no basis in actual reality or fact. You know what I mean? Have no basis in truth. I'm just sitting here thinking, so what's the alternative? You know, what can we do then? Is there something else that kind of acknowledges the pervasiveness of racism in society, but also gives us hope that there can be something better? More on that in the coming weeks.
By studying race, racism, inequality, understanding institutions, systems, right, all of those things, we actually aren't just making America a better place for African Americans, although certainly, right, that is the narrative I think people want us to understand or want us to think that is the compelling narrative. But instead, we're making America a better place for everyone. It makes America a freer and more democratic and more inclusive place for all of us.
So here we are. It seems like with critical race theory, because I still have so many thoughts. Oh my God, y'all, I have
so many.
But it seems like there's like this ground floor base level where people aren't really arguing about what critical race theory is, but what they think it is. Even if they have a good idea, in my opinion, they're kind of missing the point, because from how I'm understanding critical race theory, it isn't about everyday individuals and anecdotal experiences of racism, which is why the whole they're teaching our kids that they're the oppressor and the black kids that they're the oppressed doesn't really hold up if you understand critical race theory. Because if you understand it, then you understand that it's about looking at things on the macro and seeing how the micro is then affected. I was actually listening to a recent episode of The Daily where they were interviewing Ta-Nehisi Coates and Nicole Hannah-Jones just about all their thoughts on all of this debate about critical race theory, about moving to teach at Howard University and all that sort of stuff. It was fantastic. I recommend y'all listen to it. I'll link it in the description. But what I really got out of that talk that I appreciated was that there was such an emphasis on history in the way those two were talking. It wasn't about microaggressions or little things here and there, not saying those things are invalid, but it wasn't about the day-to-day of how racism impacts people's lives. And it was just more so about the legacy of being a country founded on slavery and not founded on slavery, but being a country that at its roots, the only reason that it has made the advancements it has, that it has gone ahead of so many other countries that have fought for their independence and won and still are developing nations, is because they didn't have to pay for labor. It's because chattel slavery, you know? And I wanna speak more specifically to the way that people argue against critical race theory, because I was actually watching a Big Joel video before I started filming this on, it was called Twitter and Anti-Intellectualism. And it was really interesting to me because I saw some similarities in what he was talking about with the content of that video and the way people argue on Twitter. He was doing like kind of a case study, but I found some similarities between that and the way people argue about critical race theory, because to me, CRT is posing an argument. It's staking claim on a stance that a lot of people are threatened by, because for white folks, it means that they have to question the morals of their ancestors, the morals of the founding of this nation, of America, Canada, again. For black folks that aren't about this theory as well, it's about refusing to believe that any advancements you made were not because of your own hard work and merit. Like I had said, a little bit of my sort of with CRT is not wanting to be infantilized. And I think there are a lot of black folks who are against critical race theory that's one of the reasons that they're against it. It's not the only reason, but that could be one of them.
You gonna personally tell a white kid, oh, the black people are all down and suppressed. How do I have two medical degrees if I'm sitting here oppressed? No mom, no dad in the house. Worked my way through college. Sat there and hustled my butt off to get through college. You gonna tell me somebody that looked like all y'all white folks kept me from doing that? Are you serious? Black folks are getting told by other black folks, oh, you know you ain't gonna be able to do nothing out there in the world because them white folks ain't gonna let you get no, oh, you know you're not gonna be able to do it because you know, the white man gonna keep you down. Well, how did I get where I am right now?
I think it's important to acknowledge the possibility of something like interest convergence, because we had a real life example. And again, that breeds a healthy bit of skepticism. But to me, on a personal level, just because I'm gonna entertain that idea and look at the government a little sideways doesn't mean that it takes anything away from me and my personal accomplishments. But I said, that's a personal thing. For some folks, it's not that easy. For some folks, the minute you take that away from them, they're like, what do I have? I think a lot of us need to examine what we're fighting for and why we're fighting for those things, because I think you learn a lot more when you're put against someone that is fundamentally opposed to the same things you believe in and you have to defend your ideas. Right now, because so many of us don't have to argue with each other and healthily debate, you don't ever have to really question why you believe the things you do and defend those things. So when somebody comes at you and is like, I think CRT is bullshit, do you really think you can fundamentally defend it without just regurgitating stuff that you have a half-baked understanding of? Do you know that you can actually stand and say, well, have you ever read any critical race theorists? Who are these people, you know? Because I think a lot of people on either side will say that they're against it and can't name a single theorist, can't name a single tenet or philosophy of critical race theory, can't tell you what intersections of like history, philosophy, legal studies, all that stuff that it comes from. You know, they can't say all of that stuff. And I couldn't before this video. So for me, I didn't go around saying that I was for or against it because I just didn't know that much about it. I had my skepticism, But I think the other reason that we should really all be examining what exactly we're fighting for and why is because if you're on the other side of this, if your why is just, I don't want my kids to be taught that being white is bad. If somebody comes to you and says, that's not what critical race theory is, here's the exact example. Do you have another defense lined up for why that's based in logic, that's based in fact of what the actual teachings of CRT are? Or do you just have talking points that Tucker Carlson told you? Do you know what I mean? And I'm not trying to be shady. Sorry, that was shady. That was real shady. I'm sorry. But do you know what I mean? Like, you have to be able to, I believe, for yourself, yes, read, take in information, have, you know, an amalgamation of all different types of perspectives and stuff and varying perspectives on things that are based in the same values. But then you have to be able to articulate them for yourself so that you can explain it to other people. And so if somebody comes to you, maybe in bad faith, not knowing, and then you're able to turn around and be like, actually, this is what it really is. You'd be surprised how it could kind of change their mind. Because I think at the end of the day, a lot of us aren't as opposed to each other's values as it's coming across. And I really want to remind us that divide and rule is not just a colonial tactic. Governments have been doing it for a long time too, stoking separation, fear, and anxiety into the hearts of people so that they have to rely on their political leaders to serve their best interests. And it's a very slippery slope, and I think we need to pay attention to that. And again, the other part of all of this is that we really need to release this obsession with individual acts of racism and bigotry, because yes, it is important to understand that these happen in very inconsequential, covert ways in everyday life and random YouTube comments, all of that stuff. But the bigger picture here is the system. What would America be without chattel slavery? You know, what would America and Canada be without the genocide of Indigenous people? Without things like the Chinese Exclusion Act? You know, what would these countries look like? How would their advancement have actually happened or not happened without the subjugation of all these different types of people, without eugenics and forced sterilization of disabled bodies? Critical race theory is scary because it challenges the narrative that history is fixed and the stories that we all always knew about our homelands weren't as true or were missing a few key details. To me, the critical race theory debate is indicative of our times. There seems to be this obsession with binaries that has trickled into thinking humans should have them too. Good guys versus bad guys. When the honest truth is most of us occupy both. We need to allow ourselves the space and grace to hold all of these hard contradictory ideas together. But again, we'll talk a bit more about, even more about binaries next week, because some of y'all, I think, need to look up Foucault's boomerang when I was talking about the whole divide and rule and all that stuff. You know, some of y'all might need to look that up, because I'm just saying, if critical race theory goes, what's next? And methinks it's not a coincidence that some of the same states that are banning critical race theory in schools are also the ones that are all about this voter suppression.
Anti-CRT related statutes have passed in 8 states and are currently under consideration in dozens more.
So this is actually a map from the Brennan Center for Justice, and I believe it's from May of 2021, although they might have updated it in June, and it's just showing the states that have restrictive voting laws or bills that have passed or have been enacted into law. So no, obviously not every single state that has passed or is trying to pass anti-CRT teaching in K-12 schools is also responsible for restrictive voting laws. But for those of you that are very concerned with freedom of speech, I don't know, this is something you should probably be paying attention to. It's always good to keep an eye on your democracy, you know what I'm saying? Either way, hopefully after all of this, y'all can have more information about critical race theory. This was just an introductory thing. There's more stuff that I'm going to be talking about, examining society, media, you know, all that stuff. So this trilogy is not over. And thank you for watching all the way to the end if you did, because this is a lot. And yeah, just make sure to always feed your plets, water your plets, and that you can always change your mind, because you can. You can! You're allowed to! Don't let people tell you you can't change your mind! That's crazy! I'm a Taurus and I'm telling you that. The most stubborn. You see? All right. I will see y'all in the next one. Bye!
What's the sense in sharing this one and only life? Ending up just another lost and lonely wife. You count up the years and they will be filled with tears. This might be too low a key. Love only breaks up to start over again. You'll get the babies, but you won't have your man. While he is busy loving every woman that he can. Say I'm gonna... say... Say I'm gonna leave 100 times a day. It's easier said than done. This heart of that music when you just can't break away. Ooh, young hearts, run free. Never be hung up like my man and me. My man and me. Do, do, do. Young hearts, to yourself be true. What did Mercutio do? Don't be no fool when love really don't love you. I said, don't love you. Should I do one more verse? It's high time now, just one crack at life. Who wants to live it in trouble and strife? My mind must be free to learn all I can about me. I'm gonna love me for the rest of my days. Encourage the babies every time they say, that's y'all. Self-preservation is what's really going on today. But also caring about the people around you, mutual aid, y'all. Say I'm gonna turn loose 1,000 times before, but how can I turn loose when we just can't break them? Ooh, young hearts, this key is so low. Run free. Ooh, ooh, never be hung up like my man and me. My man and me. Whoa, 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 young hearts, to yourself be true. Don't be no fool when love really don't love you. And bam, bam, down, said it don't love you. Whoa, 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 young hearts, clap with me now. Run free, ay, ay, never be hung up like my man and me. Or my baby and me, or my baby and me, my man and me. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Okay, I need to stop. I was just gonna keep doing this refrain. I was trying to like fade out. Okay, it's been enough time. Okay. Bye outtakes. Ooh, okay. Well, uh-oh.
Whoa, 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 young hearts, clap with me now. Run free, ay, ay. Never be hung up like my man and me.
Or my baby and me, or my baby and me, my man and me.